to share with you a robotic research project that my team is working on back at NUS, so which is a dual glove mirror rehabilitation system based on our soft robotics and sensor technology. So the clinical need that we are addressing over here is the loss of hand motor functions, which is really affecting over 20 million people around the world every year, right? And that includes diseases resulting from a spinal cord injury, stroke, brachial plexus injury, and so on. And this kind of loss of function can actually lead to grasp impairment, okay, which is the inability to flex and extend the fingers. And that can really affect the really the daily common tasks, as you can see over here. So if we look into the assistive device in the market, okay, traditionally there are rigid exoskeletons, okay, and these exoskeletons are made of rigid components, okay, based on the linkage and electromechanical motors and mechanisms, and they are placed around the hand to guide the joints and to provide assistance and functional training, right? So as you can see over here, okay, all the devices from the literature, they are really bulky and of course quite heavy, right? So these rigid components that these devices have, okay, they can only move in a single degrees of freedom. And because of that, it actually affects or interfere with the natural human joint movement, right? And then it makes the patient feels very uncomfortable and limits compatibility with these users, right? Of course, more recently, there is this development of exoskeleton that is softer and also more wearable. They are made of purely fabric and polymer. And they're also driven by cable or pneumatics or hydraulic means, right? So as you can see over here, the cable-driven devices from SEM glove and also the exo glove poly, okay, this cable-driven device, they are limited by friction and backlash issues. And very often they require wire routing and precise attachment. So if the cables are not well aligned, it's going to cause discomfort to the users. Right, and then on the other hand, we have hydraulic actuators that operate at high pressures of at least 300 kilopascal. And because high pressures is involved, okay, what is needed over here is really high cost hydraulic pumps, right? And then not only that, because it's involving hydraulics, water is pumped into the fingers. It actually adds weights to the hand. Okay, so as you can see, these devices that I mentioned earlier on. Okay, this allows the patient to be passively assisted by the robotic device. Okay, but it doesn't allow the patient to have an active role in the rehabilitative process, right? So with this target patient in mind, okay, what we want to develop over here is a lightweight, wearable, dual glove mirror rehab system that can allow the patient who may be hemiplegic, okay, to allow the patient to be able to control the peractic hand of the mirror glove, okay, with the contralateral hand action on the sensor glove, right? So it's basically mirroring, okay, the sensor glove action onto the mirror glove action, as you can see over here, okay, on the right. And hopefully through this mirror glove therapy, we can return independence to the target patients and also the allow at-home rehab for this patient. So this is the mirror glove development that has been happening in my lab. Okay, we initially started with a design concept, which is the first generation, by just simply attaching the soft actuators onto the glove. And then in our second generation, we refine the entire glove design. Okay, we make it more streamlined. And this, you can see, is the soft actuators is now embedded into the glove, right? Now, of course, recently we have embarked on our third generation design where the entire glove plus the actuators is really fully fabric and it's really more lightweight and more effective. And these are the conference papers and journal papers that supported the glove development over the past 3 years. So I'd like to share with you three key aspects of our mirror glove design, and that is the actuator, the textile, and the control system. Okay. So because the actuators that we use are made of completely soft materials, so why do you think soft materials can produce enough force, right? So in fact, we did quite a bit of research on this. So we felt that the novelty of our glove is actually the soft actuator design, right? As you can see in the top left, these are the soft actuators that we use. These are entirely made of soft silicon rubber elastomers. And compared to other soft actuators in the literature, our actuators can operate at lower pressure, less than 200 kilopascal, and definitely it can create even higher force at 10 newtons of compressive grip force per actuator. And it's definitely lighter and softer as compared to the traditional actuators. And by patterning the surface of these actuators, we can actually create actuators that can adopt complex motion, such as bending, extending, and twisting, right? And then, of course, on the bottom left, okay, this is our recent new design. Okay, complete fabric. Okay, you don't see, and it's of course lighter because, as you know, if you play with silicon rubber has a bit of weight on it. Okay, by having it complete fabric, it becomes really, really lightweight. So this is the soft actuators that we have. Now, of course, the other thing is textile. Okay, because this is a soft robotic glove, we need to be able to interface okay, the soft actuators with the human finger in order to have maximal compliance. Right. So the engineers in my lab, okay, they are not only good at with electronics, okay, with mechanical design, okay, but I must say they're also very good with sewing. Right. So we do a lot of study of textile design. We develop, we test it with different fabrics. Okay. We basically design, as you can see on the top left, actuator pockets and finger pockets. Actuator pockets is basically to insert for us to embed the soft actuators, and then the finger pockets is designed to accommodate different finger lengths and also provide an ease of use, okay, for the stroke patients, right? So you can see on the bottom right, the combination of fabric and silicon rubber, it can actually create a very robust robotic glove, right? That can withstand repeated hammering, okay, as compared to traditional exoskeleton. If you try to hammer it once, just once, okay, you're not going to have it functional anymore, okay? And then the last aspect that I'm going to touch on is the control system. How do we actually map the action on one hand to the impact hand? So we first went on to develop or set up this isolated control capability in our mirror glove, right? And that involves a combination of control strategies of the valves. Okay, and motor pump, as you can see in this electronic setup. Okay, so by controlling this valve and pump, we can actually regulate air pressures to the individual fingers, to the individual soft actuators, okay, to create any grasping postures that you want. Okay, thereafter, we then carry on with the contralateral hand action mapping. Okay, basically, what we want to imitate is the traditional mirror therapy that has been done for bimanual rehab, okay, in the clinics. Okay, where the patients will try to exercise their impact hand, okay, with their healthy hand through the use of a mirror in between. Okay, so what we are going to improve over here is through the use of a mirror glove therapy. Okay, so you can see the subject is wearing a sensor glove. Okay, so this sensor glove is simply a fabric glove, okay, embedded with our flex sensors. Right, so it detects the individual finger movement, and then it transmit wirelessly, okay, to the mirror glove, and then the mirror glove will replicate the exact actions. Okay. So before we went on to clinical trials, we actually tested the on healthy subjects just to make sure, okay, this glove is safe for patient use. So we want to assess the technical feasibility, so we went on to do some motion capture studies, right? So with the glove, we can show that the finger with the glove, it can actually provide sufficient range of motion for each of the finger joints. Okay, and this is done without active participation of the subject's own muscle contractions, right? And apart from that, we can also show that the glove, with the use of the glove, we can achieve full finger flexion, thumb opposition, and also many other functional tasks such as palmar grasp, pincer grasp. And what is really interesting is that with this glove, we can actually achieve a grip force output up to 1.5 kg, and that is really almost the sufficient force, okay, required for doing most daily tasks. Okay, we also went on to do clinical trials. Okay, we have tested on patients with stroke, patients with spinal cord injury, patients with brachioplexus injury, and then here you can see on the video they are now able to grasp a bottle or a can. And also, we are also able to help the patients open their hand, especially for stroke patients with very severe contracture. So we can now help them open up their hands so that they can reposition their hand to do other grasping activities. And then on the far bottom right, you can see using the glove, we can actually provide continuous passive motion, right? So now the glove can continuously exercise the stroke patient's hand to prevent spasticity and contractures. And in on the top right, the video is, you can see is the mirror therapy in particular. This video shows that this stroke patient who has suffered from stroke for the past 3 years, okay, can now actually control. Can now control his left impaired hand, okay, with his right sensor glove hand, okay. Okay, so what is the next step? Okay, having seen all these videos and trials, okay. So the next step is, as you can see, this technology is covered with IP, touching on the actuator design, and also the various methods of controlling the soft wearable robots. Okay, so we have recently spun out a company, okay, to commercialize this device, and our biggest market is really the stroke patients, because there's really a lot of stroke patients worldwide. Is according to WHO is 15 million new cases yearly. And of course, our business model is B2B to the hospitals and clinics, rehab centers, and B2C by, you know, providing these devices directly to the patients. We also have considered the regulatory aspects. You can see over here, this device has a fairly low regulatory barrier. Okay? And of course, based on the videos that you have seen, it's really safe. Okay, we don't apply electrical stimulus to your fingers. Okay, it's just pure air. Air is really safe. Okay, so subsequent steps will be really to put in more efforts to finish up the trials, and then we can sell the device. Okay, so that's the end of my presentation. If you have any questions, you can email me. Of course, I want to thank my grant sponsors, which is the Ministry of Education, and also the National University Hospital System. Thank you.